Praise the Christ child, the newborn prince of peace. We have been redeemed. We are no longer afraid. Praise to the God who has come to us in flesh. We are being created. We are no longer afraid. Praise to the Spirit who calls us together to serve. We will be sustained. We are no longer afraid. Come, let us worship.
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day walk on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Mary, did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy will calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels trod? When you kiss your little baby, you've kissed the face of God. Mary, did you know? The blind will see, the deaf will hear, the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. Mary, did you know that your baby boy is Lord of all creation? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day rule the nations? Did you know that your baby boy is heaven's perfect lamb? The sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am.
Good morning. What a joy it is to welcome you on this first Sunday after the birth of our Savior, to celebrate his presence among us, to open our hearts to the power of his love, and to be redeemed by his grace. We're glad that you're here. We know you have lots of choices, and we especially want to welcome those who would consider themselves guests to this time of worship. There is an opportunity to check in and let us know that you are with us in worship. There's a link to sign up for your attendance, and we'd love to know that you're here. As we begin worship today, my name is Dee Dee Roberts, and I'm one of the pastors here on staff. My colleague, Reverend Nick Shimmer, will be bringing our sermon later this morning. We are an open fellowship, and we pray that if you have needs, that you will let us know. This week, the office will be open regular hours from 9 to 3, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. So you'll have a chance to get those last-minute gifts in or check in with Cheryl while you're there. And now let's begin worship with a word of prayer. O great I Am, who lives and walks among us, we give you thanks. Open our eyes that we might see your presence. Open our hearts that we might be aware of your work. And open our lives so that we would welcome you in. Bless this time of worship, we pray, that it might be what you desire it to be. And indeed, you would be glorified and pleased by our prayers, our music, and our musings on your great and living word. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Well, good morning, friends. It is a joy and a blessing to be with you this morning, this first Sunday after Christmas, after the Sunday after the birth of our Savior. I want to echo what Pastor Deedee said. If you have chosen to be in worship with us today, thank you so much. It is a joy to be with you. If you are traveling during this time, we pray that you return safely. If you are hunkered down at home, we pray that even though Christmas Day has come and gone, that you still find yourself full of Christmas cheer. And I would be remiss if I didn't also say that for those of you that have found yourself over the last couple days having to put together playgrounds or Barbie dream houses or Lego sets, we are certainly praying for you as well and for your peace. We have all walked that road. Friends, it's an honor and a blessing to be with you to bring this message this morning. Before we get into the Word of God, let's go to Him in a word of prayer. Almighty and loving God, we give thanks to you for this day, for this opportunity to gather together as your beloved children. Though we may not be in the same room, we are tethered together through our faith in Jesus Christ, through a desire to have your transformative power continue to work in us. And so we come this morning to give you thanks, to honor and to glorify you, and to give you praise for the gift that is your Son, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God, this morning we have so many things to pray for. We pray for Nashville, Tennessee. We pray for those who were impacted by that bombing. We pray for those who see no other option in their life but violence. We pray that you put peace into their hearts, God, the peace that can only come from you, so they may be led towards a path of faithfulness and love that can only be found through your Son. We pray this morning, God, for our nation. We pray for people who are sick. We pray for people who are in the hospital. We pray for the doctors and frontline workers, the staff and the nurses who are in there bravely doing all they can, working through fatigue and frustration and anxiety to bring care that is so desperately needed to those who need it the most. We pray this morning for business owners, God, who wake up today uncertain about the future of their small business, of their livelihood, of the way they provide, put food on the table, and send kids to college. We ask that you are with them, God, that you strengthen them, that they may do their business, do their work in a way that glorifies you and in a way that is safe. God, this morning we pray for our government. We pray that they will be guided by your will, that they will seek your counsel in the decisions they make, which impact the lives of so many. We pray this morning, God, for our church right here at Asbury, for this fellowship and community of believers that you have pulled together in this time and place. May you continue to strengthen us. May you continue to open our eyes to the will and desire that you have for us as a community of faith as we seek to reach and evangelize the city of Little Rock. We pray for those in our congregation this morning who are hurting, God. We pray for those who are sick. We pray for those who are lost. We pray for those who are alone. We pray specifically this morning for Nate Hill, for Craig Cogbill, for Jan and Wesley Mead, for Jean Beth Hill and Clifford Smith, for Jenny Hill and Marcy Hall. We pray for Jesselyn Sinkhorn, God. We pray for Gwen Thorne. We pray for Kelly Ponder and John Housworth. We pray for Dick and Val Carr, Carrie Hill, June Glazier, and all those names, God, that sit on the tip of our tongue, that are in the front of our mind, and at the top of our heart. We ask that you are with them, that you provide them the healing love, your grace and your comfort, that your will be done in all of these situations. We pray this morning, God, for our law enforcement, our frontline workers, our EMT, our firefighters. We pray for our trash men that no doubt have big pickups ahead of them this week. We pray, God, for our Christian brothers and sisters around the globe who seek to bring the light into the world that is the gospel message of hope found in your Son, Jesus Christ. Many of them move in dark, unsafe spaces. And so we ask this morning, God, that you are with them, that you place a hedge of protection around them as they seek to bring others to know your love. They bring others to faith through Jesus Christ. And it is your Son, Jesus Christ, that calls us here together this morning. We celebrated his birth, God, and now we start the journey, the walk with him to the cross. Throughout this journey, God, may we open our eyes to his love and to his teaching. May we let go of ourselves and surrender fully to him. And God, may we unite in his teachings, in what he gave us in his earthly ministry, the gifts and the lessons. May we pray, God, to you the way he taught us to pray, by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Revelation. So yes, we are jumping to the back of the Bible on this first Sunday after Christmas. We are looking at chapter 21, and we are going to read verses 1 through 6a. So we will go about halfway through verse 6. You are welcome to grab your Bible, or you may follow along with the slides on the screen. Hear now the word of God. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Then he said, Write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. He said to me, It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. As Christians, we find ourselves facing and leaning into two futures. The first future is the permanent future in the new kingdom that this scripture is referencing, that God has revealed to John. It is a future that is a promise of Christ's coming reign. It is what we as Christians lean towards for our eternity. This understanding that Christ will return to earth, that he will reign for 1,000 years, a new heaven, a new earth, a new Jerusalem will be formed. The pain of the world will be taken away. God will wipe away every tear. We will no longer know death or mourning. We will no longer know hurt and pain. The sea will be removed. And this is a metaphorical description. And what God is saying is that there will no longer be this chasm between us. Between us and God and between each other. It'll be wiped away and we will all be pulled together under the lordship of Jesus Christ. That is a permanent future. That is a down the road thing. None of us know when this is going to happen. In fact, Jesus said himself in Mark 13, 32, about this moment, this new future kingdom, but about that day or hour, no one knows. Not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father. And so while we as Christians wait for this permanent future that is on the horizon that will come, we also find ourselves facing a second future. And that's the immediate future, the today future, the in this moment future of God's call in our lives. See, we also find ourselves in an in-between time, between birth and epiphany, between Christmas and the new year. Most studies will show that it is this week, between Christmas and New Year's, that more vacation days are used than any other week of the year. We use this week to rest and recoup and refocus with the new year approaching. We make our resolution list and we think about how next year will just be different. And if you're one of those people, I can't blame you. We all need a rest at times from our physical labor. We all love the idea of a new start, a fresh start, the promise that comes with that. This idea that somehow if we make a list, we can become the person that we desire ourselves to be. We have all changed in some way this year. It may not feel like it. It may not feel like we've done a whole lot, that we've just sort of coasted through. But I assure you, we have changed because every day we change. We change in one of two ways. We either grow in our faith or we run further from our faith. So I want to start our time together this morning by asking you a question that we love to ask in the Wesleyan faith. How is it with your soul? Have you found yourself at times lately not on a physical vacation, but on a spiritual vacation? Have you taken a faith vacation as the malaise of this year has worn on, which no doubt has taken a toll on your soul? With the birth of this Christ child, God has moved in. God has fulfilled the Old Testament prophecy to come and live among us. In Leviticus 26, he says, I will put my dwelling place among you and I will not avoid you. I will walk among you and be your God and you will be my people. God has moved in. And he didn't do it the easy way. This is not the easy way. It is not the easy way at all. See, we have been east of Eden since the great fall. Since our act of great defiance towards our God, we have been living in sin and we have built idols and we have divided ourselves based on what we look like and our ideologies and our political beliefs. And on all we have done in these human attempts to fix the chasm, to shrink the sea, is to create a bigger divide. Yet the coming of God's kingdom on earth, this in-breaking kingdom where God enters into our mess, creates a crisis, especially for us Christians. It gives us a view of the length that God will go to for us to redeem us and make us whole. But it also gives us a clear command for how we as Christians are to exist in our earthly life, in this immediate future that exists right now. What this inbreaking kingdom does, what the birth of this Christ child does, is it provokes a confrontation and it demands that we make a choice. I say it's confrontational because Jesus' evangelism itself was confrontational. It was countercultural, not because it changed God's laws, but because it squared them. Jesus brought a message of profound love, and he brought it into balance. He doesn't just teach us how to love, he shows us how to live it and how to proclaim it. Jesus' evangelism is bold and honest, but it is not soft. If it was soft and non-threatening, perhaps Jesus would have been a lot more popular. Perhaps the cries and demands for his death would have been non-existent, because society sure loves a non-threatening Christian. Perhaps if our gospel message was non-confrontational, all of the apostles could have lived to a ripe old age and died in comfort instead of the brutal martyrdom that befell all of them, except for John. It also requires that we make a choice. This inbreaking kingdom forces us to make a choice as followers of Jesus Christ. It's a choice that has been rooted in the call that has been placed on the hearts of all Christians, as commanded by our Lord Jesus Christ at his ascension. Matthew 28:18-20, all authority in heaven on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded to you. Jesus speaks this in the past tense. Not that all authority is being given or that all authority will be given, but all authority has been given to me, and this is what I command you to do. Our choice as Christians is whether or not we will live out that call in the present future. I read a statement this week that really challenged me, and it made me pause. And I want you to hear this. It said, "The culture is a performance review of the church." So if that is true, if the culture is a performance review of the church, I ask, how are we doing? Have we entered into a period of soft evangelism in our nation? Or are we still willing to speak boldly to the truth of Christ our King? Do we believe that just being a nice person and the you do you mindset has the transformative power for those who desperately need to hear the good news of Jesus Christ? Have we bought into this blasphemous ideology that limits when and where we can talk about our faith? Or do we see that there is no separation of church and state, because Christ the King can never be separated from the world or any aspect of it? The business of kingdom evangelization is a dangerous business. This is because the culture, the world, our spiritual enemy, will seek to put as many roadblocks in front of us as possible. It may even seek to convince us that God, that our Savior Jesus Christ, has his place in our world, and there are places where he is simply not welcome, and we do not speak about it so that we may not offend. Well, my friends, our King, our Christ, our Lord, is way too powerful for that. Are we willing to push back against the culture, to proclaim his beautiful name to all? Are we willing to face the dangers that may befall us, the dangers that our early church fathers, the apostles, faced? We're beginning a journey, my friends. Our Savior is born, and in 14 weeks, this child will be nailed to a cross, and we will gather to celebrate his resurrection. The question we must ask ourselves during that time as we move towards Commitment Sunday, into and through Epiphany, into and through Lent, and on to Easter, is, are we willing to die with him? In Matthew 16, 24, Jesus says, and you have heard this, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for me will find it. My friends, I have died a lot in recent years, but I will be the first to admit I have not died enough. I am still stuck to so much of what this world promises, these earthly treasures that I feel like I need to have that when compared to Christ are fading. I have let the culture dictate how I evangelize, how I share the message of God's loving truth and grace. I have let it tell me what I can speak and when I need to be quiet. I pray every day, and I hope you do as well, for the strength of God to help me move beyond that. Yes, my friends, as Pastor Didi said so beautifully on Christmas Eve, God has moved in. What we have to ask ourselves is what kind of neighbor we will choose to be. Will we be part of the welcome committee? Or will we be the ones who peek through the blinds just to catch a glimpse of what is going on outside? We can choose courage, or we can choose comfort. I believe that we will choose courage. Because where there is Christ, there is light. Where there is Christ, there is a promise. Where there is Christ, there is hope. And if we can share that message and share it in a powerful way, what a future that will be for us. And what a future that will be for those who so desperately need to hear the transformative, powerful story of the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are preparing to enter into a period of prayer and petition over the next 24 hours. And that will carry us into the coming weeks and months. May God embolden us, the people of Asbury. And those of you that are guests and friends joining us, you're with us too in this. I invite you to join us in this time of prayer. We will see the promise of our future as kingdom builders. As John Wesley so beautifully said to William Wilberforce, if Christ is with us, who can stand against us? If you find yourself conflicted right now, find yourself uncertain, uneasy, or unsure. The world has caused you a lot of pain this year. It has caused you a lot of anxiety. I leave you this morning with this. It is Paul's final exhortation to the church in Philippi. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all, for the Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Jesus Christ. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. The Lord your God, Jesus Christ, is with you wherever you go. In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. While shepherds kept their watching over silent flocks by night, behold, throughout the heavens there shone a holy light. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. The shepherds feared and trembled when low above the earth rang out the angel chorus that hailed our Savior's birth. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Down in a lowly manger, our humble Christ was born, and God sent us salvation that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born, that Jesus Christ is born.
Amen. Well, friends, thank you so much for being with us this morning during this time of worship. A couple of things I do want to remind you of. This afternoon at 1:30, Asbury has the privilege of serving our neighbors through the Stone Soup Ministry, located at Quapaw Quarter United Methodist Church. If you would like to be part of that ministry, I think many hands make light work, and I know that on this holiday weekend, we could use some extra hands for that, preparing that meal and then serving it to our brothers and sisters. All of that is kept very safe. Bring your mask, bring your gloves, and you can be part of that ministry. In addition to that, as Pastor Nick mentioned, we are involved in a prayer vigil beginning today at noon, lasting through until tomorrow, Monday at noon. And during those 24 hours, we're simply going to go to God, offer our joy, our adoration and praise, and also seek God's will for Asbury in the coming time. You know, we've changed a lot over this time of pandemic, and the pandemic is not going to last forever. So what is it that God wants us to do in the new chapter of ministry when we turn the page on the pandemic? What story does God want us to write? I think I know some of those pieces, but we all have to agree on that together. And let's make it a powerful story of redemption and love and renewal and transformation. So today I invite you, if you did not sign up, you can go to the webpage or to the five things that you received during the week and sign up for a time slot. But if you just can't commit to a particular time slot, just pray. And if you'd like a guide for that prayer time, there is one on our Facebook page that you can download, and we'd love to hear from you, what your impressions were, what you learned, how your life was changed during that time of prayer. So now receive this benediction. Go, tell it on the mountain, on the hilltop, in the grocery store, in your office, wherever you go. Tell the good news of how God has made a difference in your life through the birth, the ministry, and the presence of Jesus Christ. My friends, let us go, and may the peace of Christ be with us all. Amen.